Wake up, everybody, no more sleeping in bed. No more back thinking, time for thinking ahead. The world has changed so very much from what it used to be. There's so much hatred, war and poverty. Oh,
this is Black Thought, and I'm your host, Dr. Hutchinson, and we have with us the organizers of the Memphis rally, which was a part of the 100 Cities of Protest, connected with the National Action Network, and this was due to the outcome of the George Zimmerman trial. It took place in cities all over this country this past Saturday. Ladies, so glad to see both of you with us today. This is Elizabeth Hart and Charlise Clark.
Hi, good evening. Thank you for having us.
Oh, it's our pleasure. Well, let me ask you this. First of all, what made you decide to act and organize this event?
Well, actually, it's a funny story. Actually, Charlize and I met on Facebook about a little over a week ago through a mutual friend, and we saw a lot of commentary about what was going on with the verdict. And you know, there was a lot of conversation and a lot of talk, and we felt like no one was really doing much here in Memphis. And so we then exchanged messages on Facebook, and we said, you know, why don't we try to do something? And so as a member of the Memphis Urban League Young Professionals, I was on a call on that Monday following the verdict with our president, Mark Morial, as well as Reverend Al Sharpton. And he really wanted to encourage young people, young adults in our cities to kind of take charge and then be part of these vigils. And so I then messaged Charlize back and said, hey, here's our opportunity, let's go for it. And so she agreed, and that's why we decided to go forth. And we really wanted to, you know, not necessarily bring attention to Memphis as much as it was. We wanted to show that we were standing with the Martin family, with Trayvon Martin's family, but also to highlight some of the things that are going on in our own backyards and our own community, and what things we need to be doing here to make sure that a Trayvon Martin case such as that does not happen here in our city.
Excellent, excellent. Go right ahead.
I have nothing else to add. That was a great response, ditto.
Well, this is the other piece of that. When did you all finally meet?
Elizabeth and I actually met at 9 o'clock p.m. the day before the vigil.
Wow.
So Friday before the actual vigil took place is when Elizabeth and I actually first physically met.
Wow. And so you had been contacting people through social media, talking to each other in that same way, because I remember you reached out to me via social media. So basically you used that engine and others to kind of drive things.
We Elizabeth and I planned the vigil pretty much virtually, between emails, text messaging, and Facebook, and some phone calls was how we were able to actually coordinate the vigil. As far as contacting the speakers, we used all of our resources. My sorority sisters were able to get us in touch with a number of pastors that were connected within the community. We were sending emails, text messages, and Facebook messages to those speakers to get them engaged and involved in the vigil as well. So it was very virtually organized, but thankfully it came out awesome, came out very well.
All right, thank you. Quick question also. It seems like you were able to get a whole host of people to help you. I know you did a magnanimous job, but it seemed like you had a whole lot of help. How did that come to play? Because you had State Rep Antonio Parkinson helping you. You had the National Civil Rights Museum helping you. Talk about how that came together.
Well, it really kind of goes to partnerships and collaborating, and I think that's what the biggest message that we want to take away from what happened last Saturday with the vigil and moving forward is utilizing our own partnerships and our own networks of folks. And so, as I mentioned before, as a member of the Memphis Urban League Young Professionals, I then tapped into that as a resource looking for assistance. And with Charlize, she's a member of Zeta Phi Beta Sorority Incorporated, and so she used an she asked some of her sorority sisters to assist us with the binders that we use, which collected a lot of the information. So it really kind of goes into play how, you know, it does take a village to raise a child, and I truly believe that, and it took a village to put that vigil on. It's going to take a village to continue that mission.
Okay, well, let me ask this also, because it was obvious you had a lot of help. People came together, helped you, made this work. But it seems like also you alluded to, for example, the fact that you were on a phone call, that you're part of the Memphis Young Urban Professionals with the Memphis Urban League. It seems like the baton at this point is being passed to your generation, and appropriately so, when we consider that Dr. King was only 39 years old when he was assassinated, when you consider that a lot of the vanguard movers and shakers in the civil rights movement were probably your age or a little younger. Do you think that your generation is ready and also willing to take up this baton?
I absolutely believe that we are. Meeting the individuals that we did on Saturday, and Charlise can also speak to this as well, there are so many individuals that really want to help. We have been contacted nonstop since Saturday, so much so that we had to actually establish our own email address so that she and I can communicate with folks without having the separate email addresses. People really wanting to help, lend their assistance, lend their expertise. Just last evening, we met with a couple of folks who are attorneys who want to say, we want to help. If we just want to volunteer to kind of give people a crash course in this particular area and their expertise of law. And so I think that there are plenty of people who want to help and want to volunteer. The question is, what is the mission? And I think that was some of the biggest things that we talked about on Saturday is, okay, we've got this great group of individuals. We've got over 350 emails. Now what? So that's what she and I really are working on. What are the next steps? We've got the folks who want to do something, not only with the Trayvon Martin case, but also here in our Memphis community.
You know, I also think that with our generation, especially here in Memphis, they were waiting for someone to take the lead. It's not so much that people did not want to be involved. It's a lot of people just didn't know what to do, kind of piggybacking off what Elizabeth said, saying, what's next? Where do we go from here? And I think they were really waiting for that one voice to step forward to lead that, to lead the charge for them. And I think that's what Elizabeth and I did on Saturday by planning the visuals, that people are now excited. They're waiting. They're anxious to be involved, because I do think we take a sense of ownership in this next level generation of the movement.
Well, that leads me to an all-important question. What do you see as some of the next steps, and what are some of the things that you heard as some of the next steps that we ought to take?
You know, there's so many next steps that really can and should be taken. Some of the things that Elizabeth and I are doing, one, like we said, we're just gathering all of the information and the resources that we have to make people aware of what options are available. Education is so important. Political awareness is so important. Engaging our youth is very important, because this really impacts them more so than any of us, because they are the generation that will be more so impacted by the decisions that are happening today, especially in, you know, the Supreme Court. Making sure that people know the importance of voting. People know the importance of being registered to vote. People understanding the importance of knowing what you're voting about. Knowing who you're voting into office and what stances they take. It's just all about making sure that people are educated, people are informed, and people are prepared to act. And I think once people feel empowered, they're more prone to be ready to actually take action.
And I just want to piggyback on her as well, but aside from those points, also what was brought up to us is that there are not a lot of resources and activities for young people, which perhaps could lead to why the violence that's not only here in Memphis, but in other cities around the country. And again, as I mentioned before, we want to make sure that we localize this. We want to be able to, you know, to ignite this spark that everyone has right now and say, you know, let's take control of our own communities. So we really want to bridge some of the information gaps, it seems, that there is here in the city. Myself, personally, I have found out about 5 or 6 different nonprofits in the last 72 hours that I didn't even know existed. And so a lot of, if I didn't know about them, how many others don't know about it? There's an issue with jobs, and we want to make sure that if you have a job at your, if your employer, whether it's an hourly or salary or anything else temporary, we want to make sure that information gets out so that people have the opportunity to apply for those positions, because that's what you always hear is there's no jobs. I don't have anything to do, when there really is plenty to do in this city. People just don't know. So we want to make sure that we bridge that information gap. But it's also, as well as we've noticed in the last couple of days, also bridging the generational gap. So as you mentioned and you alluded to, that, you know, she and I are both in our mid-30s. You know, we also want to pass this on to those that are much younger than us. You know, the early 20s, the teenagers. We need to make sure that they have representation at the table and with us. So as we move forward, we are certainly going to be bringing 1, 2, 3 or more to the table to make sure we hear their voice and that their voice is heard.
And that's well said. And I think that this medium will be one in which we will use to help that cause and to help further things along. So we're grateful to you. And also I want to commend you. One of you is a native Memphian who's only been back in the city 3 months, and the other one of you just moved here 8 months ago, and this is your first time in Memphis. And here you are running things and putting together a large rally like this.
You know, just a quick point of correction. Neither Elizabeth nor I are native Memphians. I have lived here before, but I'm actually originally from Illinois, and Elizabeth is originally from Indiana. Okay. So neither of us are native Memphians.
Okay.
But yes, we are thrilled to have taken on this responsibility, and we have gratefully, with pause, of course, given up our weekends from here until eternity to make sure that we continue this movement forward. We won't sleep until we feel as if we have done our part. And that means, again, back to the partnerships and the networking and the collaborations. At some point, once we kind of get things off the ground and realize what next steps are, that's when we'll start utilizing all those individuals who have volunteered and said they wanted to help out. Well, there's an event on some Saturday. We need you to come out as well. So it was certainly our pleasure, and it's really honestly our civic duty to have done what we did. I personally, and I'm sure Charlise would back me up with this, I would not have been able to sleep well knowing that I could have done something, anything, and then done nothing.
Well, let me personally thank both of you. Thank you for your hard work. Thank you when you heard the clarion call, that you stepped up and responded to that call. So we're appreciative of you. Black Thought viewers, you have watched Elizabeth Hart and Charlise Clark, who organized that great rally that took place this past Saturday. Now, you say you have 350 emails. There were probably 400 to 500 people there.
Yes, we didn't get quite everybody, and so for your listeners and your viewers, we want to make sure that they have an opportunity to send us their email so that we can add them to our list. Our email address is Memphis Kindred Spirits, because we truly believe that we're kindred spirits after only knowing each other for a little less than 2 weeks. That's Memphis, M-E-M-P-H-I-S, Kindred, K-I-N-D-R-E-D, Spirits, S-P-I-R-I-T-S, @gmail.com.
All right. Thank you so much. We're going to leave it right there. Good to see both of you. God bless. You're watching Black Thought, and I'm your host, Dr. Hutchinson.